We're going to kick off today with a presentation from Tijn Buijs from Snow. Tijn, where are you? I challenged Tijn to talk about a career move he's going through. Some of you may know that in the networking industry, the average age every year goes up by one. And this in some ways is worrying. There's lack of younger people, there's not a lot of influx from other departments. However, Tijn is an exception to that. He is switching from a system administrator role to a network administrator role. And I asked him, can you share with us how does that process actually work? And I hope this will inspire some of us to perhaps reconsider their careers or to inspire young people, how do you become a network administrator? So give it up for Tijn, and I'll put his presentation on in a second.
Als hij ook daar kan komen, is dat wel handig.
Oh.
I see. Why is it not mirroring?
Yes. It was there for a sec.
Let's try it again.
Yes, there it is.
All right. Tijn, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Well, good morning, everybody. My name is Tijn Buijs, and I'm currently working on a career switch from system administrator to network administrator. And how I'm doing that, that's what I'm going to talk to about today. Well, who am I? I'm Tijn Buijs. I'm 32 years old at the moment. I'm a Linux consultant at Snow. Snow is a consultancy company, so I'm stationed at some company somewhere in the Netherlands for short periods of time, half a year, a year, something like that. I've been a system administrator since 2011 now. I've started at a web hoster, and I switched to consultancy after a few years. And since I've started at Snow, I've started to get certificates. I've got RSCE at the moment, I've got Ansible, and I just got CCNA, so that's the very start of my networking career. I'm also, my nickname, as most of you know, I think, is Cybertinus. I'm online on IRC on that nickname. I'm a nerd. I've been playing around with computers all my life. I remember programming in a child language when I was 7. So I've been doing that for a long time now. I joined Coloclue in end of 2013. I've been a board member since June 2014. And I maintain that network since half 2015, roughly. Coloclue is, I think most of you know it, but let's introduce it anyway. It's a colocation, a non-profit colocation provider, so you become a member and then you can place your server in the data center, in one of the two data centers they have. And then, Coloclue makes sure that it is connected to the internet. And I've been maintaining that network now since 2015. Why am I making this switch? I think it's time for something new. I've been playing around with Linux since 2002, 2003, something like that, and doing it professionally since 2011. It becomes a bit boring at times. so time to switch to something different. I really don't like systemd, so that's also helping to find something new. what I like about network equipment is that they are, in my mind at least, very logical. If you want to see what the status of some interfaces, you just run show command and you see whatever is going on. And if you want to change something, you need to change to that edit mode, and then everything, then you can change whatever you want to change. Sometimes they can be very illogical, I know that too, but most of the time when the theory is working, then they're very logical. And when you go to core networking, you also move further away from the end user, so you don't get phone calls with, my printer doesn't work, which is always a good thing. How do you make the switch? And the first point is my main point of this presentation, actually. You need to know what you're doing. So gain knowledge, and in every possible way you can, play around with it, or view configurations of networks, of whatever, follow trainings, but gain the knowledge before you can actually do this professionally. Seek help from your employer. That's always a good thing. I've talked to Snow about it, and they sponsor training, and they're looking for assignments in the networking department now, so they're really helping me out with that. And if your employer says, you're a system administrator and you stay that until you die, then, switch employer. That's always a possibility. Look at job offerings. That can help with the switch, but it's also an indication of what is required in the market. So then you know what to train for and what knowledge to gain. So that's always useful. And use your human network. So talk to friends, talk to colleagues, talk to the IRC channel, and ask around on how to gain knowledge, or find jobs, or maybe if someone has some spare hardware. I know there were some Cisco 6500s offered lately, so maybe that's something. How do you gain the hands-on experience? How did I do it? I started as a system administrator at my current company. And I told them very soon, actually, I was working there for a few months only, I told them I want to be a network administrator. So, and they're helping me with that, and they said, follow these trainings, and I'm following the Cisco routing and switching course now. And slowly you switch. I'm switching towards networking. What also helps is becoming a volunteer somewhere. I chose Coloclue, but the guys at Analog also need help, or join Freifunk, or help with SHA, or some event where there is a network required. And just become a volunteer there, learn from it, learn from your colleagues, and whatever you find there, just gain knowledge. And that gaining is, just do it. Play with it, play with hardware, play with virtualization, play with whatever. And it's also very important to occasionally break stuff. It's important that it goes down once in a while, especially if you don't expect it. That's the nicest moment to have downtime. Because then you need to figure out why is it down, and then you gain the most knowledge. So especially in a test lab, it's very nice. And in production, the pressure is a bit on, but it's also nice, at least when it's not too long. How can you do it? Well, there are two main choices. Use a simulator or buy hardware. When you use a simulator, there are two main choices, EVNG and GNS3. EVNG is just a virtualization software, so you can run it on KVM or VMware. You can't run it on VirtualBox, because when in EVNG you get a web interface and you just draw network devices in there, and then you got a switch or a router or whatever, and each router or switch becomes a separate KVM machine. So it needs nested virtualization, and VirtualBox just doesn't do that. So you need KVM, VMware, something like that. You don't have that issue with GNS3. That's a fully separated program. Everything runs within the GNS3 application. You do need a fairly beefy machine to run all of this, because your virtualization machine needs to run, so you need RAM and stuff like that. Or you can just buy hardware. You can buy that from eBay or Marktplaats, or talk to colleagues and friends, or find some web hoster that is upgrading their network and see if you can get their old equipment. There are all kinds of ways to get hardware. I picked hardware. This is a picture of my test lab at home. I've got all kinds of equipment. I got routers, got switches, got firewalls. There are layer 2 devices here, layer 3. All kinds of brands. You see here Cisco, Juniper, HP, Huawei, and Dell. I used different cable types. Most of it is copper. I also got some fiber. It's everything is combined. I only forgot to buy one thing, and that's a tip if you want to do this. I didn't buy cable guidance, so in actuality my rack looks like this, which is horrible, so moving on. Why did I pick hardware and not simulation? It is more real to have hardware. If you reboot a switch or a router in your simulation, then it's back online in 2 seconds. If you reboot a real router or switch, it takes a lot longer. So you see timeouts in that way and stuff like that. So it feels more real. You also learn more about layer 1 stuff. When I decided to buy some fiber cables, and then first I had to figure out which cables I needed. So multi-mode, single mode, stuff like that. And I learned new terms like OMT2, OM3. I had no idea what that was. I do know that now. And then I placed all the cables, all the fibers in my rack, and only one connection of the 5 or 6 came online. That was a connection between 2 Huawei switches. The rest stayed down. So then I had to debug what was going on. So I learned techniques like building loops and enabling non-Cisco optics in my Cisco switches, stuff like that. So it's, yeah, you learn more from hardware, in my opinion. I also hit some weird bugs in simulation. The configuration was completely correct. It was during my CCNA training, so the instructor looked at my config and said, yeah, everything is okay, but it still didn't work. It was just the simulation that didn't work. So yeah, I don't like it anymore. When you buy hardware, you're not tempted to do illegal activities, because in the simulation, you still need to get iOS or GNOS or whatever device you want to simulate. And if you don't have the hardware, then where are you going to get those OSs? Well, you can download it from somewhere on the internet. We all know that, but it is illegal, so it stimulates that a little bit. And one other advantage is that it saves on heating cost on my house, because it produces quite a bit of heat. There are also, of course, downsides of hardware. It is the most expensive option. The rack I just shown you cost me about 4,000 euros. So yeah, that's pretty steep. It makes a lot of noise and produces a lot of heat. So it's actually a downside, not an upside. So I placed my test lab in a separate room, and when I'm playing around with it, I'm not in that room. I just access it via Wi-Fi and whatever. It also uses a lot of power. The rack I've shown you takes 1.5 kilowatts while idle. So yeah, I don't have it on 24/7. I only play around with it when I actually want to test stuff and learn new stuff. And it is older hardware. My oldest switch is from 2007, so yeah, it will break at some point. It's just then too darn old. I had to replace two HP switches because they were in a reboot loop for half an hour and then they worked fine. But I thought, well, let's trash those before they don't work at all anymore. Older hardware breaks more easily. And because it is older hardware, you also miss on some features sometimes. On my Cisco 2811s, I can't run VRRP on V6 because it just doesn't support it. I also don't have large communities on my BGP sessions. So yeah, it's... yeah, please patch iOS 12 then. how can you fix that? Use other people's hardware. If you use the hardware of an organization, say ColoClue, an organization has more money, so they can buy more modern stuff. So you can play with that. At Juniper, at ColoClue, I'm playing with Juniper VMX and stuff like that, and new Ubiquiti switches, and it's fully modern. We do have large communities there. I also looked a little bit at Fusix networks, only looked, I didn't break it. And I saw differences between ColoClue and Fusix. Fusix puts more data in OSPF than ColoClue does. And that's just a design choice. Neither one is better or worse. It's just different solution for the same problem. So look at other networks. You can learn from that too. Well, how can you also gain knowledge? Well, follow training. Personally, I'm following the routing and switching track of Cisco. I've got CCNA now. I'm working on CCNP. I don't know if I'm going to do CCIE. But other brands also have similar training. Juniper has a similar track. GNCIP is on the same level as CCIE combined with GNCIE. So it's, other brands also have specific training. You can also play around with Cumulus if you want to. That's just open source and you can run that at home. But if you want to buy specific Cumulus hardware, which I would like to do, that's just not a bit too expensive at this point. It's about 1,000 euros per device. And just do as a hobby at home, you want at least two devices. So that was a little bit too expensive. And the picture at the bottom is made in my rack at home. It's I just like GNU/S a bit better than iOS, although I'm following Cisco training. Well, there's trainings aren't for free either. So the first level, CCNA, CCNP, CCNA is 150 euros per exam. And if you go higher, then the prices just go up. CCNP is 200 euros, CCIE is 1,000 or even a bit more. Roughly the same prices for the Juniper track. I don't know the prices of other brands, but I expect it's somewhere in this region. The hardware. How expensive is that? Well, my layer 2 Cisco devices I bought for 75 euros, but it goes way up from there. The most expensive thing I bought was my 3 Juniper firewalls for 700 euros. So yeah, and everything in between, it's available. So I bought a device for 100 euros, 150. I also got 7 switches the other day for 2 crates of beer. So it can go all the way. The rack itself was 500 euros. It's from StarTech to be exact. It's for a home situation, it's a very nice rack because it's open on all sides. So you don't want it in a data center, but for a test network, it's very nice. And cabling, that was for me a hidden cost. It really surprised me when I prepared for this presentation that I spent 450 euros pure on cabling. So that's power, that's copper, that's fiber. So if you want to build a test network at home, please keep this in mind. Well, how long does it take? Well, it depends on how much time you can spend on gaining the knowledge. But for me, I think it will take 2 or 3 years. In beginning of 2018, I told my employer that I wanted to switch. So then I started CCNA and stuff like that. But I've been gaining knowledge since I started maintaining the network at Coloclue, actually. So yeah, that's when it started. And I hope at the beginning of next year that I can switch to an assignment which is related to networking, because my current assignment just runs to the end of the year. So before that, I won't switch. And I do need more hands-on experience. I've been playing around with Coloclue. I've been playing around there a lot. And it is a good network. It's most of the time it's stable. If it's not stable, then I'm sorry about that. But it's one solution for the problem, and it's a fairly small network. So yeah, if you scale up, then I just don't know how to do that yet. So I hope to find that in the near future. This is actually the main point of my presentation, apart from bragging about my home lab. Practice, practice, practice. If you want to make this switch, make sure that you know what you're doing with networking. You don't have to be an absolute expert, but yeah, if someone says OSPF to you, then you need to know what that is. I say break a lot of stuff. So what did I break in my learning? At one point, I broke IBGP for entire Coloclue, so then the entire network went down. I was building the Ansible playbooks to deploy the firewalls on the routers. The routers at Coloclue are just Dell R610s with Debian and BERT on them, so it's very easy to maintain with Ansible. It's just IP tables. And I deployed that, and I had a filter in there that allowed for all the network cards that to talk BGP on the subnet the interface was configured on. But I only had that for the physical devices, and I totally forgot about the loopback interface. So yeah, the IBGP sessions went down. Solution was simple, of course, just add the loopback interface to the whitelist, and then IBGP came back online and everything worked again. Some while later, I broke only IPv6 for Coloclue. We deployed RPKI on our network. And then a complaint came in that a V4 range wasn't reachable, which should be reachable. So it was an error on the side of the owner of the prefix, but yeah, we wanted to fix it before they fixed the actual issue. So I updated our deployment software to allow for a whitelist. So I can just say, well, even though this prefix is invalid, just accept it. So I built that for V4 and I added one entry to it. But for IPv6, we didn't have any entries for the whitelist, so the whitelist was empty. So that resulted in an empty prefix list in the BERT configuration. And when you do that, then BERT thinks that no route matches the prefix list anymore. So the entire route table for IPv6 was emptied and V6 went down. Solution for this was very simple too. I just updated our automation software to see if a whitelist was empty, and when it is empty, it doesn't configure any whitelist in the BERT config in the end. So then V6 came back online because it needed to be fixed before I emptied out the whitelist for V4, of course. Otherwise, we would have lost V4 too, which would have been bad. Then we hit a reserved word list change in BERT. I updated it from BERT from version 1.6.3 to 1.6.4, so that's a very minor update, you would expect. But the reserved word list was changed, and we used a word which was now on the reserved word list. So BERT said, well, this is a syntax error, I won't start. And then it emptied out the entire IPv4 and IPv6 route table on the routers. So that router went down. I also found out that day that the out-of-band management of that router wasn't working anymore. So I had to drive to Amsterdam to fix it. And when I did that, then yeah, just changed the variable name to something else. Also updated our automation software, of course. And then everything worked again. And the last one, that was just a couple of weeks ago, was the IPv6 maximum neighbor cache. I was doing a normal upgrade on the routers, just apt update on Debian. And then a new kernel was installed, so I had to reboot the router. Well, that's all fine. But this was our M6 facing router, and on the M6 there are a lot of neighbors. And they all started at the same time to talk with our router again. And just the neighbor cache was just too darn small. So the router started to drop random neighbors from that cache. And especially if it drops the other routers in our network, then IPv6 isn't that stable anymore. This was a very simple solution, just increase the cache. So I increased that by x8 or something like that. So now we're safe for the near future. A few years ago, we hit a very similar issue for V4. That was just a MAC table that was just too small on the router. So we upgraded that a few years ago already. And now we hit exactly the same issue with IPv6. So yeah, that's what I wanted to talk about. Does anyone have any questions about this?
So in summary, you switched your career out of boredom. You were done with Linux. You're like,
actually, a little bit, yeah. And networking is also interesting, which I found out when I started at volunteering for Codeclue. So yeah.
Well, too bad you didn't switch to OpenBSD as a hobby.
My test servers in at home are all running OpenBSD. So I've got 5 OpenBSD servers in the rack.
Any questions from the audience for this fine gentleman? Or perhaps personal experiences that can be shared from your side?
Yeah.
I think you can better use this microphone that is... And say your name and affiliation.
Hi, I'm Guido Kroon. I work as an ethical hacker at Deloitte. I have a question for you. Do you feel, as a former sysadmin, that it actually really benefits with a network administrator? And do you see that it would actually be helpful to have a former sysadmin background and to go into network engineering?
It gives a different perspective on it, of course. All the debugging skills I learned as a sysadmin, I can just deploy on networking too. And especially when you look at a network as Codeclue, then it's all running on Debian and stuff like that. So then it's really helpful to know Linux and not only Juniper routers. So yeah, I think it's an advantage. And yeah, it's just a unique perspective on the whole subject.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Erik Buys, A2B Internet. Tinus, did you have a look at the vendor hardware pool to actually look at specific hardware and basically ask them, can I borrow some hardware for this and this purpose, see how it works, those kind of things?
No, I did not, because I just like the idea of owning the hardware. And then I can just keep it at home for as long as I like, and I can just keep it for years to come and just play around with it and just build an entire different network on it. Or when I want to support an event like SHA or something, then I can just pick up some hardware and use that. It's too old for that, but in theory I could do that. So I just like the idea of owning the hardware better.
Okay.
All right, Tijn, thank you very much for sharing your experiences. Much appreciated. Give him a warm applause.